Hello, and welcome to this video, where I'll be talking about the Cursors Everywhere demo, which is effectively a Chrome extension which allows for anyone to enable shared cursors with anyone else on the internet, so that you can see where someone wants to point at or indicate some point of interest on a web page when potentially browsing the internet with colleagues or friends. We'll be looking at the hurdles that I encountered when doing this, the considerations you need to have when creating shared cursors, as well as also any interesting outcomes I discovered and tips and tricks. The initial decision that I made in terms of how to implement this was to make it a Chrome extension. This makes it quite accessible. This makes it easy to install in that you just need the crawls, which you can then look at, and then you can simply import it as an extension. I also wanted to simply share the coordinates of positions as well as have unique IDs. For example, I can see that when hovering over this, this is user R5XOH87. And to do that, I have decided to make use of Ably, which is a PubSub broker, which uses WebSockets as its real-time communication protocol. And this effectively, as a PubSub server, means that you can have as many clients as you like all listening in on a web page for subscription, for message updates on where cursors are, as well as also publishing those messages to the PubSub broker to indicate to others where their cursor is, without having to worry on the client side about scalability of handling that distribution to potentially thousands of users. And then, effectively, in order to communicate the coordinates of the actual cursors, my initial implementation was very simple. I simply made use of checking the X and Y coordinate of a cursor and then making it a percentage of the page, just because I was aware when starting this out that probably people were going to have slightly varied browser pages, and it seemed like a first good step. And you can see that when the browser is pretty much the same dimensions and same positioning, everything works out quite well. The representation seems pretty good in terms of where we're roughly indicating. The issue, of course, is that as we scale the browsers, that representation gets worse and worse. So here, although we're on top of the L, actually, we're representing as being between the two O's in Google. Likewise, it's no good for actually trying to indicate to a particular element. So with the consideration that what I'm truly wanting to do with this demo is effectively allow for indication of key important elements on the page, I then decided to try and integrate element definitions within the message being sent to other clients. So for example, here, I'm simply extracting the element which is beneath the cursor at any moment. And then, if there is an ID, I will update that and consider the ID element, our element's ID, and then send that, which means that we can consider the kind of percentage position within that element and also uniquely identify the element for another browser to highlight. The issue is that for any elements without an ID, there isn't a very clean way to indicate an exact element, because that is not how HTML has been developed. It is not developed to have unique identifiers for every single letter, every single character, every single element. So there is a way to somewhat try and work around this by making use of the CSS path, where effectively you consider its relative position to everything else in terms of CSS and elements around it to try and uniquely identify something. The issue lies in the fact that this does not always actually uniquely identify something, as well as the fact that browsers, especially in this day and age, tend to be very dynamic in terms of the positioning of elements and the classes and such which are attached to elements. So this makes this not very reliable, but it's a step in the right direction to allow us to identify some things. So here I've commented out the section which makes use of it, but here we have a consideration for if there is an element, that is where we select stuff and try and make use of that element to actually position things from the receiving side. And likewise, from the publishing side, we make use of that get CSS path element we just referenced. So we can see if that makes any improvements by actually loading this updated version where we're allowing that code to work. And if we go, let's say, instead to the Ably website and refresh these pages and go to cursor sharing, enable it. It seems to be working on that one. This one's working here. As we're kind of hovering, we should actually now see that although currently we're showing as being on the Ably logo when we're not, the important thing is when we're on an element, we'll then actually snap to being represented correctly on that element and its rough positioning. Again, because of the fact that, for example, here, there's actually a gap between these two things. One is a text, one is an image. So there's a weird kind of snapping thing where it's like inaccurate to suddenly being accurate again as we reach over. But overall, it's considerably better, where then suddenly, if I am actually highlighting an element, it will actually be on said element. The next consideration was then for how you actually, let's say for text, where you might want to highlight a certain specific character, how do you do this? The answer, unfortunately, for most websites, is that it's quite hard to do because, again, as much as there's no element unique identifier, there definitely isn't a unique character within an element unique identifier. Not to mention that potentially you can have text changing in size and length and all of that. So in order to try and actually experiment with what would be required, I made a very basic website, which we can see here has some text on it. And if we inspect the text, we can see that each character I've identified uniquely. So in this sort of scenario, if you have somehow the capacity to do this, you can now suddenly actually have very useful, detailed representation of specific characters. So even though here, for example, the text line actually goes to the next line, so blah, 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 is no longer actually in the same place at all, and not by the X and Y coordinate standards. However, despite that, if we refresh these pages so they work with the current plugin, we should see that if we place our cursor here on an A, it is actually still on the A on this position. And likewise, if we move this character here and shuffle along slightly from the cursor to the text, we should see it go around. So that's the sort of power that you have when trying to actually control a specific website, which you have control over. The more identifiers you have, the more precise you can be in your representation of the cursor position. So in terms of this plugin, that's about as far as we can take it, but it's worth then actually considering how a professional solution actually does this, where you can have shared cursors in, let's say, Miro. The way Miro does it is that it doesn't try to actually represent the cursors uniquely within a browser web page. Instead, it has its own representation of a space, this kind of infinite scrolling space you have within Miro, where this is a canvas which does have defined coordinates for everything, which are unique specifically within Miro. So for example, if this is 0, 0 up here, it is still 0, 0, even if we scroll all the way down over here. And even if we zoom in on the page, we're just getting more and more precise coordinates. We're not actually changing the scale of the space itself. So because of that, that means that if we do place, let's say, a text box up here and say hello, then suddenly, although on the page that may be completely off screen, because there's a shared canvas represented within Miro itself with a set of coordinates for everything, that means that we can, within our communication of messages, actually just say hello is in, if we considered it to be at 0, 0, 0, 0, and then we indicate scale and we indicate positioning and all of that. And because it's a actual shared state with a shared understanding of what values represent within this canvas, it means that we actually have the power to then represent it accurately for all clients. So when making your own actual solution, making use of cursors, this is the sort of approach you should really go for. You shouldn't be trying to map browser pages to certain elements and positions and all of that. You should be working on creating an abstract representation of the space outside of the browser, which then the browser interprets to then actually render where things are on the page. If you're interested more in the code on this, then you can find it in a link in the description to the Cursors Everywhere demo and blog piece in the description of this video. I hope you found this useful. If you have any questions, please leave comments in the comment section, and I hope you have a great day. Thank you. Bye.